Good morning. Thank you all for coming to the 16th annual Deinard Memorial Lecture on Law and Medicine. I'm Susan Wolfe. I'm chair of the university's Consortium on Law and Values in Health, Environment, and the Life Sciences, and we are one of three sponsors here at the university of this event. Hari Asofsky is with us, who is the director of the Joint Degree Program in Law Science and Technology in the law school. That's another sponsor. And Professor Susan Craddock is director of the Center for Bioethics. So this is a three-way enterprise. We all would like to welcome you here this morning. As far as I know, this remains the only lecture series in the United States that is devoted to issues at the intersection of law and medicine. I know I'm preaching to the choir here because you've come for this event. This is an intersection of tremendous importance, growing importance, and the blue ribbon lineup of speakers that we've had over the years for this lecture series attests to it. Some of you are veterans. You've been here to our lectures before, and you know we've covered topics ranging from healthcare reform to the role of neuroscience in the courtroom, genomics, really a broad swath of topics. And the topic that brings us here today is, again, right at the cutting edge. This is the grand finale of our lecture series. And so instead of bringing you one speaker, we've brought you four. And we're going to follow an unusual format. We're going to feed you so everybody can get through it all. We're going to ask each of our wonderful speakers, who I'm going to introduce formally, to come up and talk for about 15 minutes, really just to get us started. And then I'll just take a question or two quickly, maybe a question of clarification, or I've got an urgent remark after each, so you're not just sitting here. But then after all four, they're going to come up and join me up here so we can really get to the meat of it, which is dialogue with you about these cutting-edge issues and the new model of research, of patient-driven research and innovation that's really exploding on the internet, in our medical centers, in our communities, really all across the world, and posing some radical challenges to how biomedicine progresses. That's really what we're here today to talk about. This visionary series is supported by a generous donation from the family of Amos Deinard Sr. And it honors the memory of Amos Deinard Sr. and his brother Benedict Deinard. I wonder if you would join me in thanking first the family, the children of Amos Deinard Sr. And they're right here, Professor Amos Deinard Jr. and Miriam Kellen. Thank you so much. Also sponsoring this series is the law firm of Stinson Leonard Street. The new-ish name sort of disguises the connection. This was the firm of Leonard Street and Deinard. And they've been tremendous partners. I don't know whether Sheva Sanders is here with us right now or Byron. Right there. Sheva, thank you so much for your leadership at the firm. I just want to give you a sense of the tremendous careers that we honor in holding this series in memory of the Deinard brothers. Both were founding partners of Leonard Street and Deinard. Both attended the University of Minnesota Law School as well as Harvard Law School. Amos Deinard Sr. was a distinguished attorney widely known for his persistent work to eliminate discrimination in hiring. appointed to the Minneapolis Fair Employment Practices Commission in 1945 by then Mayor, this is a test, Hubert Humphrey. He served on that commission for 17 years, 15 of those as chair. His brother Benedict Deinard was a successful trial attorney, an adjunct professor of law here at the university, a deputy attorney general in the U.S. Department of Justice during World War II, and one of only four civilians asked to participate in the Nuremberg war crimes trials. A fund was created in their memory to establish this lecture series. Our topic today, how patients are creating medicine's future, from citizen science to precision medicine, really could not be more timely. When the White House announced the National Precision Medicine Initiative, now called All of Us, I'm getting used to that. I'm still calling it the Precision Medicine Initiative. They said something very important, that this huge national research project would be patient-powered, with participants involved in every step, design, governance, the whole thing, and with full access to their own data, their interpreted results, and the aggregate results of the full million-person-plus cohort. All of that builds on the emergence of the new models of research that we're here to talk about today. Research designed, driven, governed by participants themselves. We have really an extraordinary and very interdisciplinary panel here today to discuss the enormous potential and the not insignificant pitfalls of these new emerging models of patient-driven research and innovation. I'm going to introduce them each formally, but just to give you a sense, Professor Jason Bobe is here, and he'll speak first from the Icahn Institute for Genomics and Multiscale Biology at Mount Sinai School of Medicine in New York. Then Dr. Ernesto Ramirez will speak. He's Director of Research and Development at Fitabase. He'll tell us something about that. Professor Kingshuk Sinha, who is here at our university at the Carlson School. He's department chair and professor in the Supply Chain and Operations Department. He's going to talk and bring a very interesting angle about patient-driven inventions as well as the big picture. And fourth, Professor Barbara Evans, a longtime colleague of mine, our lawyer on the panel. She's from the University of Houston Law Center, and she's going to explore these new models and some of the challenges that they bring. Each one, as I said, is going to talk for about 15 minutes before I invite them on stage to talk with all of you. Now, when we get to questions, and as I said, I'll take a question or two just quickly after each, there are mics. You see them at the end of the aisle if you just come to the mic. And it would be great if you could just say your name and your affiliation, because there's such expertise in this room. I've looked down the list. It would be great to begin to get to know each other, too, so you can keep talking beyond this one event. As with most of our lectures, this event is being videotaped, and that video will be posted on the consortium website shortly after the event for free public access. So feel free to use it in teaching, to share it, to send the link. That's what it's for. Please silence all your phones now so that we don't hear that on the videotape. And we would ask that if you need to step out, that if you could use one of the back exits rather than the front, then that will avoid showing up on the tape too. Some of you are getting CME or CLE, continuing medical education or continuing legal education credits. If so, you do need to remember to complete a participation form. Those are at the registration tables that you saw when you checked in. other health professionals can submit a statement of participation to their accrediting organization or state board for consideration of credit. And an evaluation will be emailed to you later today. We would love it if you would fill it out. We read every single one. We really take your comments seriously. So if you just take 5 minutes to give us your feedback, that would be much appreciated. Disclosures. All speakers and people involved in planning this filled out disclosure forms. They're up at the registration desk if you'd like to look at them. The only disclosure for this event is that Dr. Ramirez is an employee of Small Steps Labs, LLC, which supports the Fitabase data management platform. One other crucial thing I need to do before we get to the meat of it is to extend an enormous thank you to our staff. Please, if you get a chance to thank them yourself, none of this happens without tremendous work on their part. And if you join me in just thanking them, that would be great. Okay. So now let's get to it. Let me introduce Dr. Bobe. Jason Bobe is associate professor and director of the Sharing Lab at the Icahn Institute for Genomics and Multiscale Biology at the Mount Sinai School of Medicine in New York City. His research focuses on collaborative and participatory models of biomedical research and innovation, exactly what we're here to talk about today. He has a long history of work in this space. At Mount Sinai, he's leader of the Resilience Project. We were talking about it last night. An effort to learn how some people are able to avoid disease despite having certain genetic risk factors that would predict disease. Since 2007, he's been working to develop a global network of personal genome project research studies that collaborate on the development of personal genomic technologies and practices at larger and larger scales. He's co-founder and director of two nonprofits, personalgenomes.org and diybio.org. Most recently, he's co-founder and project director of Open Humans, a project backed by the Knight and Robert Wood Johnson Foundations that invites individuals to build highly integrated longitudinal research profiles that they can then easily donate to advance medical science. Jason.
Thanks, Susan. Okay. Well, it's a real honor to be here, and thanks to my host for inviting me, and thank you all for coming. I am consider myself a biomedical science producer, and I'm the only one in the world because I invented this term myself. But I'm here to tell you that the experts that we've been missing in medical science are the patients and the participants. And the future of biomedical science and the advance of medical science relies on better engaging them. And so I do quite a bit of speaking to biomedical and health research groups of people, and so I'd love to take just a quick poll and see a show of hands of the number of people in this room who are actively enrolled right now in at least one biomedical research project where you sign a consent form, there's a principal investigator, you could withdraw if you wanted to. Let's see a show of hands. How many people? Not so bad. I don't know what that is, 10%, something like that? It's not unusual that the rates are relatively modest, although I would say in this room there's more than in typical rooms that I visit. But if you go around asking people the things that they care about, like the UN did to 120 countries, you find almost always, universally, health and healthcare near the top. And health workers among professions are among the most trusted professions. Lawyers and marketers are near the bottom. Scientists, interestingly, are kind of in the middle of the pile, but healthcare workers, nurses, and clinicians are always rated near the top. Yet, do people participate in organized health research? The answer is no. And so the question that I'm really interested in solving in my career is what I call the participation paradox, which is why is participation in organized health research a fringe activity? Particularly if we all care so deeply about health and healthcare and advancing the health of our own bodies and those of our families and communities. And so I would like to just highlight in the first couple minutes some of the main, some of the problems that I see. This is by no means a comprehensive list. But first, and maybe foremost, people's mental models of biomedical research is it's an area of last hope. It is, if I get cancer and the first line therapy doesn't work, maybe I'll enroll in a clinical trial to get access to an experimental therapy. It is not currently viewed as the first step towards solving a problem affecting my own personal health or the health of my family or my community. And that's a major problem. Another problem is that if you don't go to a physician who's part of an academic medical center, chances are very good that you've never been invited to a formal health research study. That it just is not something that is part of our culture that people have. It's not that they wouldn't participate, it's that they've never been invited. And then, but I want to be sure to not impress upon you that this is purely a problem of marketing, where if we were to be better advertisers of health research studies, that we would get more people to sign up. I think that is true, but I think there are also really major problems with how things are currently commonly governed. And basically, I would say, to make a generality, that the research enterprise, as it's currently constructed, isn't designed for you. It's in many ways designed for the researchers who are asking the questions and have their own priorities that are different from your priorities and the priorities in your health and healthcare. And so one example of this is there was a survey a few years ago of that people who had enrolled in health research studies. And they asked how many of you received even a summary of the results of the study that you signed up for that you were told like what the outcomes of that study were. And fewer than 10% of participants had received what the results were. And this is not the type of environment that we're going to get broad participation in. And so I would like to turn to some of the operators that are out there on the front edge who are working largely outside of organized biomedical, the research enterprise, and who are not satisfied with waiting for sort of trickle-down innovation from the researchers at the institutions who have so far done, in many cases, a poor job of engaging them and meeting their values. And so these are just a few stories of things that I think are indicators of maybe a new future. Hugh Rienhoff has, who I met, him and his daughter at the White House, daughter B, has some unusual traits like curved fingers, and he was worried that underneath these symptoms that there might be a larger health issue lurking, that if he knew something about it, he could be a better father and caretaker and be sure to give her the longest and highest quality of life possible. But he ran into dead ends in the established medical enterprise, and so decided to expedite the diagnostic odyssey of his daughter by setting up a home lab to do low-cost DNA extraction and shipping it off to vendors to help do processing and recruiting researchers, willing researchers, to be basically consultants on this project, rather than leaders, but consultants on his project to help his daughter, and ultimately made a discovery that was published and is appears to be explanatory causal variant involved in this new disease affecting his daughter. Sharon Terry was not in biomedical research at all, but was in divinity school when her and her husband, who was from the construction industry, had two children with a rare genetic disease. And at the time, there was no diagnostic test and no therapy available for this. And so they stopped what they were doing and started a nonprofit and went around the world collecting all of the individuals who also had this disease and were the reason why they were able to develop a diagnostic test and are on the path to develop new therapies for people affected with this condition. And although she's not formally trained as a scientist or a clinician, she's had over 100 peer-reviewed articles published. And I could go on and on with these case studies. And Ernesto, I think, is going to talk a little bit about this community who's recently emerged, who goes by the hashtag We Are Not Waiting. And they had a somewhat seemingly simple problem, which was, as type 1 diabetics, that they wanted to be, who wore onboard glucose monitors and sometimes insulin pumps, that what they wanted to do was be able to get that information of their real-time glucose readings off of the devices, who were only, that data was only available to the clinicians and to the vendors, but not to the patients. And so they said, you know what, we're going to design our own devices. And that's what they did. And this is a photo of her showing the NIH director, Francis Collins, how it works. And he's got the device in his hand and showing that she can read it from a smartwatch. And her and a community of open source developers went outside the system to make this happen first. And so there are some other really enabling factors for these sorts of things to be happening. I'm going to go through a few of my favorite examples. So the cost per genome, you've probably seen this slide a dozen times, that it's faster than Moore's law. So, you know, zeros are dropping off every year at the cost of a single human genome, starting, you know, with, you know, billions of dollars for the first one from the Human Genome Project down to less than $1,000 today. And, you know, these technologies were only available to elite institutions. This is the Whitehead Institute, who was participated in the Human Genome Project. But now these devices are available on your desktop. They have a spot for your iPhone to plug in. Some are now mobile and disposable, and you put your DNA specimen right in that little drop, and it puts the data right onto your laptop computer. And so now you're starting to see a new group of people who are using this. So this is a group that is, it's a community lab, the first community lab in the United States that anybody can sign up for, like a gym membership. You pay a monthly fee, you go get access to advanced biotechnologies, and you can you do it just from an educational purpose. You can take classes, or you can bring your own research questions in. And there are more than one of these now. There are dozens of groups around the world, and you can track them on this organization's website and get involved if you like, called DIY Bio, which is something I founded in 2008. And even the youth these days are getting involved in biotechnology. So this is Fred Turner, the 2013 UK Young Engineer of the Year Award, who made a home DNA photocopier, basically, called the polymerase chain reaction machine, PCR machine, that's there in his basement. And one other really important enabling technology, which is really the story that I'm emphasizing here, that the means for production of new medical knowledge is increasingly in the hands of the individual. And they no longer necessarily require the need to run these studies through formal institutions, and can increasingly, if they want to, take it upon themselves to maybe consult with medical institutions, but run them on their own. And so this research kit is a framework that you can now do studies on your iPhone, mobile device. And I just want to give one example of something that was run on MGH, where they had a question about the relationship between blood sugar and exercise and people with type 2 diabetes. You would think that we would have tremendous knowledge about this, but before this study, the largest study, previous study on this question, enrolled 75 people and took 2 years to generate knowledge about that. And they were able to set up this study, recruit 300 people over a 24-hour period, and make a new insight into the relationship between exercise and glucose levels. And so now, in the last few minutes, I just want to talk about a few of the remarkable features of some of the studies that I've had the good fortune of being involved with. That I think are path-breaking in different ways. And so the Personal Genome Project, this was started by a geneticist at Harvard Medical School, by George Church, who said, hey, it's time to move to make the model organism be us. But there are questions, and he published his editorial in 2005. He said, first of all, will people sign up to share extensive information? And if they do, will they be discriminated against for it? Because you have to remember that in 2005, this was, you know, 3 years before GINA was passed, the Genetic Information Non-Discrimination Act. There was no ACA, which prohibited pre-existing condition discrimination. But the study went on, and the world changed around it. And there's a lot of unique features at the PGP and the things that it did. One in particular, which was really path-breaking, was that any research data that was generated in the study, if the genome was generated in the study for the individual was the first person to get access to that. And then they had the choice to either withdraw from the study, take their data and run for the hills, or to make it publicly available. And one of the things that we learned is in doing it this way, of putting the participants in the driver's seat of making the sharing decision, not the researchers making sharing decisions on behalf of the individual, that we started to see how the power of reciprocity and the ability of and the interest of people showing up and being more involved. And so openhumans.org is a new effort that basically extends that model where the participant's in the driver's seat, because it's the belief that your data is more powerful when you're part of it, and that you can have ongoing agency and make decisions about which data and to who you can make decisions, the sharing decisions about. So I encourage you to go look at that. And this creates a new concept of an open cohort, where basically the data doesn't only exist to be controlled by the principal investigator who generated the study, but the individual also has access to that data and can make a second set of determinations about who else might want to have access to this data. And maybe there you could put it on Wikipedia, you could donate it to your favorite cause, you could share it with another research study, and there's no longer exclusive control by principal investigators. And so in the last couple of minutes, I just want to tell you about a new study that I've been working on designing and trying to take some of the best practices that I see out there in these different areas of participatory health research and applying them in an area which is really exciting, which has to solve for this participation paradox, which is the Resilience Project. And the hypothesis of this study is that we've been missing a whole stream of people in biomedical research, people who are healthy. And so typically the path for people to get involved is that you get sick, you go to a doctor, and you get a diagnosis, and along the way they say, hey, did you know there's also this disease registry? There is this study, we're looking at people who have this disease and we're trying to answer these questions, would you like to get involved? But people who are healthy never get that invitation. So we think that we've actually been missing some really important avenues for generating new medical knowledge. And this turns basically the current model of disease research upside down. And it's not just looking for the absence of disease, but it's looking for the absence of disease where people have certain disease risk, where we would anticipate that they should get certain signs and symptoms of disease, but they don't. And so it's a hard challenge. I sort of liken it to, we have to develop these new bat signals out there that we can try to identify people who are walking around with superhero traits, and they don't even know it necessarily, because the outward signs of resilience look very similar to just health. How do you know that you're healthy because you are resilient, or you're healthy just because you lack a disease risk? And so building systems to try to help people identify whether or not which is the case is what we have to do. And so I just want to give an example of a story like this. So this is a guy, Stephen Crone, who was unfortunately one of the first, his partner was one of the first people in the United States to die of AIDS. And this was before we even knew what HIV and AIDS were. This was, got sick in the late 70s. And he said, hey, so then he went and got HIV tested for years, assuming he was going to die of the same thing. And it always came back negative. And he, after a while, talked to the clinicians and said, hey, you know, I think there's something funny going on here. I think I'm resilient to HIV. You should study me. And finally, after years of him saying, you should study me, somebody did. And they took some blood, they took the cells, they took some of immune cells out of his blood, they put him in a dish, they gave it a massive dose of HIV, no infection. Oh, we made a mistake. Let's get another tube of blood, do it again, no infection. And this was in the 90s, so they couldn't just do a whole genome sequence, and so they had to be smart and try to look for the thing that was giving him protection, and they identified that he had this mutation that was protective, that involved a receptor that was like the docking station for HIV to get into the cell, but his was broken. And so then three drug companies jumped in, and two failed, but one small molecule was effective at basically giving the same resilience to everybody else by blocking this receptor in people who had normal copies of it. And that was FDA approved in 2004. And so all of this started from one New Yorker raising a hand and saying, I think there's something special going on in my biology. And so this is another case that we're working on where we've started to go out and systematically look for these individuals. And this is a case of an individual who has had 12 family members die of a genetic version, a really nasty version of Alzheimer's. That average age of onset is around 40. And this guy lacks signs of this disease, and he's now almost 70. And so we don't know how common this is because nobody's gone out to systematically study it, but we think it's an important avenue of research. And so I submit to you to consider participating in organized health research and being involved, because it could be the case that something in your personal health experience could be the key that solves somebody else's disease. Thank you.
Let's just stay up here for 1 second. We can take a question. Okay, if you would identify yourself.
Yes, I'm Phyllis Kahn, currently state legislator in this area. And there's something that I thought I knew, and that your example was that there's a big discrepancy between adults participating in research projects and children participating. So people who are not willing to go in it themselves are somehow willing to put their children in. I don't know if that's true or not. It's something I read somewhere.
I would be really interested to know that. I don't know.
Pretty sure it was published in Science.
Okay.
At some point.
Yeah.
Okay, great issue that we'll save
okay.
when the panel gets up here.
I will definitely look that up. I'm interested in that. Thank you.
Okay, wonderful. Our second speaker is Dr. Ernesto Ramirez, who is Director of Research and Development at Fitabase, a research platform that collects data gathered from large groups of internet-connected consumer device wearers. Fitabase is Fitbit's clinical research partner and frequently collaborates with academic institutions. Until recently, Dr. Ramirez was the program director at Quantified Self Labs and is the lead editor for quantifiedself.com. He communicated about how self-tracking and personal data are impacting our culture. He's also a recent grad of the joint doctoral program in public health at UC San Diego and San Diego State. His research at the Center for Wireless and Population Health Systems at UCSD focused on understanding the behavioral techniques people use when they're interacting with health technology. Join me in welcoming Dr. Ramirez.
Thanks for having me today. I'm really excited to be here and speak to a little bit about less about my current position and more about this general idea of self-tracking data. So let's get started. I have to have this really fun slide here. I am an employee of a for-profit company called Small Step Labs. We make Fitabase. As Dr. Wolf mentioned, helps researchers get access to wearable device data. But I'm not really going to talk about that right now. I'm going to talk more about what kind of data is available for us to use and learn from in our daily lives. So for the physicians or people in the health research field, can anyone tell me what this is? Anyone have a venture a guess? This is the very first EKG. This was produced by Dr. Willem Einthoven. He's a Dutch physiologist in 1901. So if you can see, he has got two hands in buckets and 1 foot in bucket. That's 3 leads. So those are a saline solution. And so what they're doing is measuring the electrical conductivity of the heart. And so fascinating, 600 pounds this thing weighed. He actually won the Nobel Prize for creating this machine. Now, we all know that ECGs are really, really important. Understanding our heart is really, really important. But what's fascinating to me as someone really kind of interested in the way technology is changing our culture, especially around health, is that it only took about 100 years to turn this 600-pound machine into something that looks like this, which some of you may have and some of you probably are wearing right now, which is the Apple Watch. And this is one of a variety of different devices that can measure your heart rate at a pretty decent accuracy, if you look at the research literature, right from your wrist. And it's not just heart rate that's available for us to understand through the course of our normal everyday lives. We have step trackers like things like Fitbit and Garmin. We can have continuous blood pressure monitors that connect wirelessly to our cell phone so that we can keep track of our own blood pressure. We can step on a scale in our bathroom, have that wirelessly sent to a server through your Wi-Fi signal in your home, and be available immediately whenever you want to check your weight. The one here on the very, very top, your right-hand side, is an Alive Core. It's a mobile ECG, so actual clinical-grade, FDA-regulated ECG device. Put your fingers on it, snap it in the back of your phone, and you can actually see whether or not you're in AFib. And that's just some of the many, many different devices. But on top of devices, we have services. There's probably people in the room here that go out for runs, maybe not in weather like we have today here, but like it's more like where I am from in Southern California. You know, nice weather, you go out for a run, you start your Runkeeper, you start your Strava, or your Map My Run to see how fast you're going and where you're going, create those maps. Or you're maybe tracking your sleep with different mobile applications or devices. Or if you want to get really, really fancy and really kind of out there, you're taking a swab of your fecal matter and sending it off to a lab in Palo Alto so you can test your microbiome to see, wait, you know what, is this probiotic yogurt that I'm drinking every day, is it actually doing anything to my gut microbiome? There are people out there doing that. And all of this data is becoming really, really interesting, and it's huge. I'm just going to go through a few examples of my own personal data to kind of give this some context. So this is a really, really messy, messy graph. But what you are seeing here is 18 million steps that I've tracked through a Fitbit device over 5.5 years. And so you can see, obviously, I fall asleep where there's no information here in the middle of, you know, from midnight around till about 6, 8 a.m. is when I typically wake up. And then you can see definitely patterns. I don't run in the middle of the day. I either run rarely in the morning or I run in the evening. That's where you see those very high dots there. But what about other behaviors? So I use a mobile application that, for better or worse, was bought by Facebook some time ago that automatically tracks your location if you have it running on the background of your phone and automatically categorizes your movements throughout the day. So I live in Southern California, in Los Angeles, and this is everywhere I have walked in the 3.5 years that I've lived there. This is every single route I've run, and this is everywhere I've biked. And so if we think about this data, you know, even if just my information, I have now going on, you know, 6 years of every minute of the day having something that's tracking my physical activity. I have something that's tracking my location. I have something that understands whether or not I'm in a car, whether or not I'm walking, whether or not I'm sitting down, riding a bike, you know, or in some cases in an airplane. And this huge amount of information is becoming immensely powerful because it's deeply personal. It's about my own physical experience in the world, and it's happening for a long period of time. Not only that, it's real-time data. Because all of this data is connected to something that I'm holding on my body, my cell phone, that is also connected to the internet through Wi-Fi or some 3G or LTE signal, it's accessible for people to do things with in real time. So I can give it to a researcher, or I could give it to a healthcare provider so that they can understand what's going on with me. And this that comes to this portable aspect of being able to share that data from a technical perspective. But aside from the technical perspective of like signing up for an API and granting access through entering a password on a website to let someone look at my data, this data is also shareable from a social context. So as was mentioned, I was a part of this organization called Quantified Self Labs. Although many people have heard of the term Quantified Self, a lot of people don't really understand the background. It was started, Quantified Self as an idea and an organization was started by two gentlemen in the Bay Area in 2008. One of them up here is Kevin Kelly, who was the founding editor of Wired magazine, and then his writing partner, Gary Wolf. And they basically said, hey, people are tracking lots of things. Let's get them in the room to talk about it. And their very first meetup, they had someone come in late. They said, all right, you're the last person that came in. You tell us what happened, or tell us something about yourself. That gentleman opened up his laptop and said, here's every 15 minutes of my life that I've tracked for the last 5 years. Let me tell you about it. And that just blew open the doors of, wait a minute, people have these interesting stories, and they're learning about their own lives through tracking information, whether it's pen and paper, whether it's creating custom code, or using off-the-shelf devices. And that one little small group of 30 people in the Bay Area has now since, in the last 8 years, turned into 111 groups around the world in more than 30 countries, of which there are 25,000 members of people who have at least signed on to say, I am interested in sharing my ideas and learning from other individuals. And so those groups meet in small communities all around. There's ones in Austin, there's one we have in Los Angeles, obviously in the Bay Area, but also across the world. And they basically do what we call show and tell talks. It's very much like kindergarten. You go in and say, hey, I'm doing this thing. Here's what I'm learning about it. And what we try and do is try and make sure that that information is also shareable to a broader community. So if you go to the Quantified Self Vimeo group, there are 800 videos, usually very short, about 5 to 10 minutes, of people telling their stories. And those stories are fascinating. It's everything from, hey, I learned how to track my food and I was able to lose weight, to you have the gentleman up here in the second column on the very top who said, I was learning how to track how much knowledge that I can jam into my brain using something called spaced repetition, and I'm one of the leading winners on Jeopardy. So all across the board, people are doing very, very interesting things around this idea of tracking themselves. But it's not just like useful for these individuals. I think it is useful, and we've seen that it's useful from a broad variety of contexts. And I'm going to go through some very specific examples here. Jason brought up Research Kit, which is a SDK, an open source SDK that Apple provided about a year ago to the community. And what that allows is researchers of all types, whether it's you alone coming up with a good research project, you know how to code, to develop a system to generate data from a mobile phone, to put an application in the App Store to allow someone to consent to participate in a research project directly from the app, which is phenomenal. From the research standpoint, this stuff just never happened before. You usually had to have someone come in, sign a real piece of paper, and then answer surveys and contribute data that comes from that phone and connect other data sources. And what happened when Research Kit came out, they had 5 initial applications. And every single one of those applications that was talked about on stage at one of these Apple gatherings just had a huge amount of interest, a huge amount of participation right off the bat. Jason brought up the type 2 diabetes study out of Mass General. Just blew out of the water the number of participants that are typically seen in these trials. I think the other example that we know of was done by some of our friends over at Sage Bio Networks, which is a nonprofit in Seattle. And they did a Parkinson's app. And so they used different features of the phone to try and understand people that may be at risk for Parkinson's or people that already have Parkinson's disease. And I think they said the biggest study that had ever been produced was about 200 people with Parkinson's, trying to measure their activity over time. And this study had 19,000 people within the first 2 months participating in it. And this is not just Apple specific. I don't want you to get that sense. Some very innovative researchers at Cornell have taken that open source framework that Apple created and put online. You can actually go up on GitHub right now and look at it, and have ported it over to Android. So if you're a researcher and you want to do this type of work and you want to work with populations that use Android phones, there's something called Research Stack that you can go look at. It's basically built off of that same idea. But it's not just useful for us as researchers. I think there is a huge amount of potential to bring data that is impactful for individuals into the communities. This is an example from a private-public partnership. Propeller Health is a company based in Madison, Wisconsin, started by a clinically trained epidemiologist. Basically said, we need to know where people are actually using their asthma inhalers. So what if we just put a little GPS chip on top of your inhaler, and every time you click that down to get treatment, we just take exactly that latitude and longitude of where you are. And they partnered with the city of Louisville and their innovation department to better understand how asthma is being exacerbated in the city of Louisville. They've shown, before they did this project, the city of Louisville had some very poor air quality data, and they wanted to know, how can we be better? And if we actually make changes, public policy changes, can we see that it has an effect on those that are most affected by poor air quality, our asthma sufferers? And so they, with support from the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation, did a small trial of 300 individuals, found fantastic effects. Found that people were highly engaged with their own data, and that the public policymakers, the people there sitting on the city council, could see what was actually going on. And they received another round of funding to break that out not just to the city, but to the entire county, and increase their population to 2,000 people. This is a great example from a friend of ours in the QS community, a PhD student in Sweden, Sarah Rigger. She was diagnosed with early onset Parkinson's in her mid-30s, which is typically rare. And she took it upon herself as a trained engineer and now researcher to better understand her disease and her treatment. Her current treatment consisted of taking 6 different medications at 6 different intervals in 6 different doses across the day. So very, very complex. And she wanted to know, what is it actually doing to my body? And am I actually getting different effects with these different doses? And what happens if you maybe take this pill later on in the day versus earlier on in the day? And so she started doing a self-tapping test. Little program on her iPhone and tablet, wanted to just test her finger dexterity, which is a good indication of Parkinson's disease. And she was able to take this self-collected data, see what was going on, and have a more in-depth conversation with her neurologist, her clinician, so that they could more adequately change her dosage to reflect her personal experience and how her medication was actually treating her versus just some average population. And then the last two examples Jason alluded to, it comes from the diabetes community. This is a community that I think for good reason call themselves the very first self-trackers. Data is a huge piece of the of individuals' lives that live with type 1 diabetes. Having to understand their blood glucose, having to understand their diet, their stress, their physical activity, how much insulin they need to be taking. And you know, recently there has been this great innovation called the continuous glucose monitor. So rather than going through taking a finger prick and putting into a machine to get your blood glucose values, you can actually strap on this tiny little device, has a very thin thread. It's testing your blood glucose every about 15 minutes or so, wirelessly transmitting that to a little device. And some very enterprising fathers with who have children with type 1 diabetes said, let's look at the code that's powering this device, see if there's a way that we could kind of peek under the hood a bit. And what they were able to find is that they could piggyback on top of that communication protocol between the device you wear on your body and the device you put in your pocket. And what they created was this hacked solution, which is now a huge open source community called Night Scout. And what this has enabled has been real-time sharing of continuous glucose data. And that sounds very, very boring. But for the people that do this, the people that have to live with type 1 diabetes, it has been literally life-changing. I'll show you an example in just a second. Anywhere from, I don't have to worry about possibly dying in my sleep because I don't hear an alarm going off when my blood sugar is too low, because my parents are also able to look at my data, to parents who can finally say, you know what, my wife and I can go out on a date because we can see how our child is doing remotely rather than having to just be there all the time to make sure something doesn't go wrong. And that Night Scout solution, which is, you know, taking this huge amount of data and making it more open and available, pivoted into something phenomenal in the medical field, which is an open source artificial pancreas. The artificial pancreas is the holy grail right now of type 1 diabetes, other than a cure. You know, if a cure comes along, great, but right now, what some enterprising individuals have created has basically been, like Jason said, a way to connect what's the treatment, which is your insulin pump, to the feedback, which is your continuous glucose machine, personalize their algorithms, and then have something on board that they can control and they understand to better manage their type 1 diabetes. So I have a short little video that's going to probably tell it in a much, much better way than I can.
Sam was diagnosed at the end of the summer, being sent home with a 9-year-old kid. That's type 1 diabetic, and it just felt like I was coming home again with an infant. I pretty much moved into Sam's bed because of the fear during the nights.
You have to check every 2 or 3 hours, because they could get low blood sugar to the extent that they lose consciousness and they never wake up.
I felt very helpless. For the first time, my kid was needing something that I couldn't provide. Yeah, it breaks your heart.
He was scared of doing certain activities that he loved to do. That was lack of freedom for him. I went on Twitter and started researching. I met the founders of this effort called OpenAPS, Open Source Artificial Pancreas System. They hacked together a device that could prevent spikes in blood sugar by adjusting the insulin automatically, like an autopilot. I was amazed with the results. We said, you know, let's make it happen for him. We want to have that too.
The idea was simple. Sam has a pump that delivers insulin. He also has a CGM device that checks his glucose level. And the whole concept is to connect these two together. The beauty about IntelliMedicine was that it has everything that you need as a mini computer. So Sam can carry this anywhere that he goes. I'll never forget the first time we made it through the night without Sam's glucose alarm going off.
That was golden for us.
Within a few months of using OpenAPS, Sam's average blood glucose dropped to a normal range. It's like a miracle. We started sharing the outcome to use this not only for our son, but also make it available for others that are dealing with this condition.
This is personally my favorite.
And now a year later, we have more than 100 people running the same system. Since day one, we believe that technology can help. It may not be the cure, but it's the closest thing to a cure.
So I'll just say that to me, that example is the leading example of this bottom-up approach that Jason started to talk about, of people saying, we think we can do a good job of creating something using our own personal data that's going to have a clinical effect on our lives. Two bits of background that I think you need to know is that, A, there's no FDA-regulated artificial pancreas currently on the market, and there's currently 174 individuals, I think probably a little bit more today, that are using this artificial pancreas. And I'll wrap up here by just saying that as people in health research, as people trying to understand the legal implications and the clinical implications of all of this huge amounts of data, I think we get wrapped up in the fact of how much data there actually is and what's in our spreadsheets and you know what's going to end up in our papers. But there's behind all of that data, there's people. That's people's information. You know, that's a child's blood glucose numbers. That's someone choosing to step on a scale every morning. That's someone that's strapping on a blood pressure monitor because they want to know something, and they're trying to look for some information. So I'm excited to take some questions or and talk further about this later on panel. So thank you very much.
Quick question. Hari, do you want to go to the mic?
I am Hari Yosofsky. I'm a professor in the law school and direct the joint degree program in law science and technology. And the example you gave is actually quite personal for me because I have a child who's a type 1 diabetic. And one thing I was intrigued by is sort of this question of how this open source conversation that you're describing interacts with the state of medical research. Because as I'm sure you well know, Medtronic has had a first step artificial pancreas for some time, my son's on it, and that solves that nighttime problem. Mm-hmm. I mean, except that the sensor's a little erratic. But so they for a while have had this step one where it can automatically shut off insulin. It can't correct your blood sugar, but it can solve the low problem, which for us was huge as he went to sleepovers.
Sure.
But now, of course, Medtronic has gotten approved the first artificial pancreas. The only problem is it got approved so much faster than the FDA usually approves things that it's not quite out, but it's expected out this spring. And so, I mean, which should have, from a sort of a company where you just buy it out of the box, the same kind of functionality that they're describing. And so I'm curious sort of both, have you seen an interactivity between the pace of medical research within these companies, et cetera, and their device production timelines from this open source work, but also sort of how consumers navigate this open source world as it interacts with the rapidly developing field of medicine in that area?
So to that effect, I can say that there has been a lot of interest from your regulating bodies like the FDA to better understand these communities, specifically the Night Scout OpenAPS community, but also patient-generated data as a whole. And the FDA is currently evaluating how to better integrate data that's generated by patients and participants in trials as part of the regulation process and the approval process. I can say that that community has actually had very good luck talking to the FDA and helping them understand that things can move faster, especially when you talk about medical devices as software rather than actual devices that someone has to implant or ingest. And now there's different ways that those are being regulated, and the speed of that regulation is improving. And I think there are ways that people get around this. Like, this is not a medical device, because people can do, you can do whatever you want. That's part of the great thing about living in this country. You know, you can do whatever you want to your body, and that's what they fall under. So I would say that the good news is that there are people that are listening in these bureaucracies that exist in the world, and they're trying to hear how to, you know, and try to understand how they can do better.
Let me introduce our third speaker, Dr. Kingshuk Sinha, who is a colleague here at the University of Minnesota. He's chair of the Supply Chain and Operations Department, and he's also the Mosaic Company Jim Prokopanko Professor of Corporate Responsibility here at the Carlson School. He additionally serves as graduate faculty in the Bioinformatics and Computational Biology program. In the realm of health and medicine, his research advances an end-to-end supply chain-centric view of the healthcare sector that links development of care to delivery of care. He also applies big data analytics to disruptive adverse events such as medical device recalls. He's concerned with designing and sustaining healthcare supply chains for underserved communities as well in developing and developed countries to focus not just on improving quality and affordability of care, but also on reducing disparities in the delivery of care. KK.
I can begin by saying good afternoon. What can I say? It's intriguing. It's really informational and also very, very inspiring to hear what the two speakers, scientists, spoke. Now you have to listen to a business school faculty who is neither in law nor in medicine, right? I'm truly honored and feel fortunate to be part of this group and have this audience before me. At one level, I feel like I'm a newbie here, a kid in a candy store, especially when I hear all these different technologies and also the people. I mean, nothing is more poignant and personal to see with Sarah or Sam doing what they do and how what we are talking about helps make their life a little better every day and so much for their parents. So it's truly something that I've learned, and I think some of my colleagues have helped me to learn every day. Susan Wolf is certainly one of them. Pamela Jacobson, who's in the audience, is part of clinical pharmacology, is one of them. And Ellen Demerat, we're kind of doing this. So my perspective is to say, wow, so much is going on, so much good is going on. How can we scale up? How can we sustain all these wonderful things and bring to bear the fruits to both what I call the haves and the have-nots? I'd really like to make three points and hopefully provide some perspective which is related but somewhat different from the vantage point that I sit, which is a supply chain, where we worry about how do you connect development, production with consumption on a reliable, replicable, sustainable basis. High volume, reliable, replicable care. And in this particular case, the development and delivery, how do we link the development and delivery of precision medicine? The second, and before I begin, which I must admit, is not something we can take for granted, especially when we look at when the clinicians talking about pharmacogenomics technology. I think it's fairly obvious that on one hand we see advances, but the adoption, the development is moving along, but the adoption is lacking. That is of interest to me, and that's the kind of work I do. Citizen science, I think, as we have talked about this, is truly fascinating, and in a way that it complements what I would call the investigator-driven science. It's not an either-or proposition. I think we are all enamored, intrigued by what citizen science can do for us, while being mindful that there are people with great credentials are working in laboratories as passionate. So it's not an either-or. But more importantly, I feel what intrigues me about citizen science in particular, for the first time, I begin to see that I think we have a potential to reduce the disparities in healthcare, especially disparities in the delivery of precision medicine. And I say this most sincerely because I think it's fair enough to say, and I could go out on the limb to argue, that as we have made progress and marvels with all these marvels of modern medicine, actually our disparities have gone up, not gone down. And so here is an opportunity as we are pursuing precision medicine, which is still in a very developmental stage, to start thinking in terms of how do we also start worrying about the disparity? Is there an intersection between these two? And citizen science perhaps provides one of those opportunities for us. So why not take advantage of this? Some of it is come back to some of the work that I've been doing, not necessarily in the US or in the managed care or in the Western world. Some of these are basically work done, for example, this piece of framework that I'm sharing with you, it's an empirically tested framework on providing care to kids who are born with congenital heart disease in Lanzhou, China. 6 times the national average of China, the kid, that's the typical statistics. So we're looking at what helps to realize the demand, i.e. the volume of surgical care for these patients. We know the typical drivers are, of course, affordability, access, and not last but not the least, awareness. What I think, and I'm intrigued about at a more fundamental level, is this idea how citizen science and everything that we have heard for the last two speakers is this creation of awareness. Awareness for the provider, but also for the patients and the patient families in a way that engages you. They engage you, feel empowered. And at least some of the work that I have done demonstrates that you can reduce the cost of care, you can provide all kinds of access, as in Lanzhou, China, yet folks don't avail the care, even if that's handed on the platter. So there's something about awareness, let alone participate in the clinical trials and everything else. So I think we also, based on what I just heard, Ernesto, social media, be it in the form of online data sharing, mobile apps, is certainly proven to be an enabler of citizen science, and more so in the context, as we have heard, on the delivery of precision medicine. So those are really broadly my 3 points that I'd like to dwell on, and then look back a little bit on what I would call some of the past, because in some sense, from where I sit, for what I do, a bit of there's a reinventing going on. But I hope this is a different time around where we can bring to bear and stuff to fruition in a sustainable and scalable way. So one of the persons that truly intrigued me is this gentleman that you have on the screen, Dahl Goldsworthy. And as the you know, as the title suggests, he's an engineer who fixed his own heart. But more importantly, it's just not his own, it's others too. Dahl was here in 2013. We had a forum called, like this, called Patient Innovation Forum, largely to talk about how patients can truly help themselves and patients and their family. And Dahl was a magnificent speaker, if only you could live with his French. Right. He was so ticked off with NHS. He's from England. He's from Gloucestershire, England. And he was so fed up that he decided to take what I would call medicine in his own hands, not law, medicine in his own hands. And he had Marfan syndrome. And he did not quite like what was going on, nor did he want to live a life such risky as typical people have. And so, as he said, I don't want to live my life in a cotton wool cocoon. So he engineered himself a solution. And the solution is this, what you call external aortic root support, because it's to do with aorta, and provide a fixture outside, not inside the aorta, which worked. Tal was a booming, buzzing, live individual who entertained us for the 3 days he was here. He flew across the pond, and he's still living and helping others out. So it's truly inspiring to see what patients can do for themselves and then do for others. If that is the promise of citizen science, there are also perils. There are what we call serial inventors out there. One of them is affectionately known as Dr. Nakamatsu in Japan. He claims that he's trying to treat his own cancer. The problem with this effort, knowing that we have a lawyer going after me who will speak to some of the downside risks and how do we curtail and protect the downside risk as we are realizing the upside potential, is when people engage in, as we call, his own therapy, he settled down, as one would say, a bullet list, a point list of therapies. And as you can see, they are eccentric. But more importantly, it's very difficult to go through a trial. And so hence, there's a question of how scientifically tenuous they are. It's raised from food, tea, and a whole bunch of other things. So as we think about, and as from where I sit, about these upside potential, the promises, I think it's fair enough to look at the downside risk as well. But needless to say that I personally, as I've gotten into this space, continue to be intrigued and inspired by the promise. Now, as we've seen in the case of Sam, it's just not about patient, but also patient families. Too often we see, you know, mothers taking care of their son, in this particular case, a son who has Angelman syndrome, sees every day of the challenges the kid has in terms of walking, and then ends up being in this unique situation that, you know, there's a neighbor's birthday party going on, and begin to see some behavior or actions that she has never seen as the kid reaches out to these floating helium balloons. That gave her an idea, and an idea that she's pursued with, you know, with great passion, and helped to come up with a contraption which has subsequently helped this kid. And then thereafter, as we have seen, you know, this word gets around. And I think what we are kind of charged for ourselves is how can we scale up the word getting out. The context in which I picked up this is one of my friends up in Portugal, Pedro Oliveira. Pedro has been part of this initiative with MIT, with Eric von Hippel, who created what he called the Patient Innovation Forum that I talked about a minute ago. And they're documenting such instances and trying to make these available and making people aware of this so that people can reach out to one another. We've known of kids born with cerebral palsy and all the challenges that goes along with it. And once again, a mother comes up with this great idea of what you call the cute turtle collar, knowing that kids, you know, people who have cerebral palsy tend to hypersalivate, which is neither fashionable, and it can be have a stigma. But in this particular case, this simple contraption helped to absorb the slobber, and frankly, was stylish as well, and gave this kid a new life altogether. I shared this with you because I think there is some message here that as we start looking at broader samples of such individuals, to begin to understand who are those individuals who engage in these patient innovation. And it's not surprising from this kind of more of an empirical study that was done with a fairly large sample, and this was again Pedro's work, is the fact that, you know, their people have education, and then the fact is they all love to see the impact these contraptions or these innovations have had post, you know, they're being put into use. So Taking this further, let me sort of view this from a lens of an oncologist. And beginning to sort of see from the delivery side that this is Julie Vose speaking. She's the president, or was the president of American Society of Clinical Oncology, acknowledging this idea of collective wisdom, and therefore the formation of what they call the cancer link, but more importantly, recognizing how to engage patients in a more active way. And it's sort of a two-sided story, because on one hand, that we see there are avenues of the providers coming together, and then there are the patients' communities together. And I think one of the things we have to see and we have to figure out, and perhaps in meaningful legal ways, is how can we open up these floodgates? Because the reality is, I think Ernesto in some ways, I think Jason said it in some ways, it's amazing that when I first read the statistics that people who have cancer, the adults, 3%, only 3% really enrolls in clinical trial, which effectively means if you're an oncologist giving care, that there are 97% who do not enter clinical care, trials, and therefore you have to deal with such people, those patients coming in, and typical patient would probably be from that 97% as opposed to the 3%, which obviously creates its own challenges. So this idea of an online community, I think Cancer Link has been hugely helpful. There are things like patients like me, which have come along, which is more of a patient community, and it is beginning to cater to a whole bunch of different disease conditions. But more importantly, I think there are some studies that do indicate, large sample studies that do indicate, that there are benefits related to treatment, symptom management, clinical management, and outcomes. One area that is largely been, we are generally quiet about, is area of mental health. And the reality that, you know, some of these apps can actually provide what you call social support. And patients like me, this online support group, have had some studies done and basically find that these apps do provide what you would call informational support, emotional support, besides companionships. And I think they have been very systematically trying to understand what that really means from item-wise and capture the real impact. So in other words, the efforts are beginning to in play that separate the wheat from the chaff. Right here at the University of Minnesota, I thought I'd share with you, in the spirit of mental health, that mobile apps are beginning to be created as a way to provide capacity for care to especially students who are prone to depression. I mean, this is a non-crisis depression cases. One of our students, an alum, Adam Moyen, has come up with what you call marbles. It's still in a work in progress. But more importantly, I think it provides the students an alternative avenue to get what you call 24/7 support, but more importantly, to track data of the depression over time and then identify behavior. So this data can be analyzed and we can sort of do some predictions. So in closing, as I said, I really had, you know, three things for us to ponder about, which is, as much as we get enamored and excited about the development side, I think let's try to also think in terms of how do we link with the delivery side so that we can reduce the lag time. We leverage citizen science as perhaps a new opportunity now as we pursue this paradigm of, you know, precision medicine, to think about the disparities, improving awareness, improving affordability and access. And finally, the social media, again, is so it seems like a great confluence, and I'm excited to be a part of this. Thank you.
We can take a question. Yes.
Thank you. Carolyn Hiller with the Medical Device Innovation Consortium. When you were talking about patient access for genetic testing and precision medicine, one of the challenges may be payment as far as access for reimbursement coverage. Do you have any thoughts on how that might move ahead?
Yeah, and I think since you're part of the Medical Device Innovation Consortium, one of the things that we have to be mindful of as we come up with these devices, particularly, and also to start thinking in terms of the devices in use, which is what I call innovation in use, to begin to start understanding how can we design not only for features and functionality, but issues of design for affordability. That's at the heart of this issue. And more so, I kind of pull it back to these, you know, for example, whether it's a medical device center, medical device, all these things, that it's about time that we really take that to heart. And people have been talking of frugal innovation. So that's probably the starting point. And then we can get into, you know, the reimbursement piece. But I think if you can drive down the cost, adoption, reimbursement becomes a lot easier. And that has to be something we have to pursue simultaneously as we pursue new features and functionalities.
Great, thank you.
Thank you.
Our fourth and final panelist is my colleague Barbara Evans, who is the Alumni College Professor of Law and Director of the Center for Biotechnology and Law at the University of Houston Law Center. She's also an affiliated member of the Center for Medical Ethics and Health Policy at Baylor College of Medicine. She is really a leader in thinking about large health information networks and legal issues in genomics and precision medicine. And her many recent activities include serving on the National Committee for Vital and Health Statistics, on the National Academies Committee on Future Technology Products and Opportunities to Enhance Capabilities of the Biotechnology Regulatory System, and on the FDA's Sentinel System Privacy Panel's Patient Engagement Working Group. She regularly collaborates with researchers on a variety of projects. In fact, she was just here last week working on one of our NIH projects, a range of projects funded by NIH, FDA, and the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation. Join me in welcoming her.
Thank you, Susan, for that introduction. And also, I'd like to thank our sponsors and also the law firm for their hospitality since we've arrived. And I'll get right to my topic. I have three themes that I'd like to talk about. The first is that there are grand scientific challenges in the 21st century. One is the Precision Medicine Initiative. One is to understand what the human genome does and how it works. Others are to unlock Alzheimer's disease, to cure cancer. All of these require enormous data resources. And they also require something else. They require us to rethink the role that ordinary citizens play in scientific research and what citizen science means. My second theme is that citizen science implies a new citizen-driven bioethics. We sort of assume that we can just keep the same old bioethics and apply it to this new thing, but I hope to persuade you that that won't work. Along with greater participation in science, people want a greater role in enunciating the ethical and privacy standards that govern their involvement in science. And it's sort of like a popular uprising against the bioethics establishment. And we've all heard of the Common Rule, which is our major research regulation. I abbreviate it CR, and we're about to have Crexit. People want to exit the Common Rule and make their own bioethical standards, and I think that's one of the big trends we see. And my last topic is going to be that this is more than making people happy. If we don't engage people, we cannot create the data resources that we need to do all this wonderful science. So it's essential for the science as well as for patient engagement and satisfaction to get them more involved. Jason has mentioned that we have this problem that most Americans say they would like for their health data to be used for socially beneficial purposes, but they don't do it. And that's really problematic. Why is that? One possibility is that they are not happy and not comforted by the ethical and privacy rules that govern their participation and govern the use of their data. Something's holding us back. It should be really fun to be involved with all this wonderful science, but we hold back. And I think with the best intentions, we invented a system of bioethics that allows people not to be very involved in designing the research or deciding what will be done with their data and whether the resulting products will be put in the public domain or will they be sold? Will it be a drug that gets sold for $800 a pill? They have no say in that. They only have a say in one thing, and that's whether they will consent to let their bodies or their biospecimens or their data be used. And people want more than that. That's a very minimal level of participation. This article by Kelty, again, Jason, Bob put me onto it. It's a wonderful article of what does it mean to participate. One thing that makes you feel like you've participated is to get an educative dividend, to learn something by participating. We've had such resistance in the bioethics community at times to letting research subjects have access to their own data. It's been feared that we would have psychosocial harms or we would put burdens on the healthcare system if we had information and that it might be damaging to us. That keeps us from getting an educative dividend if we can't find out what they discovered about us while they were doing research on us. I think at times we've been considered too fragile, that we're presumed to be very sensitive people, and I don't think that's an accurate reflection of how human subjects are. Many people who could be human research subjects have served in the military with great valor, or they may have jobs in which they take significant risks every day for the benefit of our society. Now, I'm a lawyer. I'm not in a high-risk profession. And yet, for those of you who are law students, I want to say that on my first trip I ever took as a new lawyer after I graduated from law school, it was my first big business trip, I got kidnapped off a train by armed Transnistrian separatists and held hostage in the Republic of Moldova. So don't assume you're in a safe position. But when all of us look at how brave we've been in various contexts, it's almost insulting to say we would have psychosocial harms if they told us a gene variant that we had and they couldn't tell us the answer of what it meant. I think most of us can take that sort of stress, and I want a bioethics, and I think most people do, that assumes we're brave and will embrace these risks and doesn't protect us so much. Another thing, we want access to decision-making. What research will be done with our data? What terms will the products be sold on? Naturally, we can't exclusively control that. The investors have a right to have a say in it too, but we want some voice in it. A third thing is that we want control or ownership of the resources produced by our participation. And I highlighted produced. There's this enormous debate raging now about owning our own data, as if that would answer our need, if we could control the inputs that we put into the research. Well, of course we want that, but we want more. We want some control over the outputs of our research. We want to be able to, as I mentioned before, perhaps not have our data used in research that's going to make exorbitantly priced drugs. We want the price of drugs that use our data to be reasonably priced. And we want an outlet to specify some of the terms and conditions. Now, this fourth thing is all the common rule has given us, voluntary participation and capacity to exit. It's the only thing on this list that I see we're getting from our current ethics. Effectiveness of voice is important, not just that we have a say, but that it means something. Not just that we get to comment on the ethics rules after experts have kind of talked down, told us what they would be. Our current system of participation in the development of regulations deems us to have participated if we comment, "I really don't like that." That's not the same as being involved from the outset when the rules are being written. Finally, we want measurable participation, and we want an effective experience of participating. We want to feel like we're part of something, that we're really involved. This is why engagement is necessary. In the 21st century, we need to bring data together at a scale and to a depth that we've never done it before. This is a little schematic. The people across the top are symbolically the whole human population. And then there are many entities with which people have encounters in the course of their lives, and those encounters generate data. Ultimately, to do the best science we'd like to do, we need all of that data marshaled in a way that it's usable for public health and for discovery. And that's quite a problem. Just the many different formats it exists in means it's going to be costly to bring the data together. And as you see, there's sort of two ways you could organize this. You could have the people be the ones each to get their data and bring it together, or you could rely on the data holders, the people who have it stored, and have them be the prime movers. Now, there are several problems that are making this data aggregation more complex than it has ever been. How are we on time? 5 minutes, good. One is that the mechanisms we've used before to share data, such as de-identifying it, we all know there's skepticism about the re-identifiability of data. If you bring all of Mary's data together and have the whole longitudinal trajectory of her health history, there will be no one else in the world that has that same exact trajectory. So the data become intrinsically identifying. The problem of re-identification is that the notion that Mary's data could be used to re-identify who Mary is. That's not the extent of the problems we face in this new data environment. There's also privacy interdependency. When you have really detailed information about a lot of different people, you can actually run grinding algorithms. I've seen some fascinating demonstrations where if Paul's data are identified and Sue's data are identified, you can take an unidentified data stream and say, well, that's not Paul, that's not Sue, that's not anyone related to Sue, and you can back into Mary's identity using other people's identified data. So we're interdependent now. What you do with your data affects my privacy. That means that no longer is my consent sufficient to protect me. If you consent to having your data used, that can affect my privacy. So our whole thought about the value of consent is sort of not true anymore. So we have these problems. Now, this is my last slide. And it sort of is another schematic. All or almost all of our data are held by someone other than us, a hospital or an insurer. To mobilize data, you sort of need two parties to want to do it, the people holding the data and the person about whom the data are. And in this, I'll start and go clockwise from this upper left quadrant. In quadrant one, both the person who the data describes and the data holder want to share the data for use in science. Then it's relatively easy to make that happen, to move the data into a resource for science. The problems are, though, that there's still a cost to make the data interoperable, so you need a financing mechanism. But if both parties consent, there's a high likelihood you can make data sharing happen. Over on the upper right, it's a very common situation where the data holder would be willing to share the data, but the person is uncomfortable with it. Our current regulations, the Common Rule and HIPAA, actually anticipate that situation and have mechanisms that allow a data holder to decide to share data without consent through granting a waiver or something like that. The problem with those mechanisms is they're breaking down for the reasons I just described. We no longer trust de-identification to protect the privacy of data. We have great concern about granting waivers without people's consent, so it's becoming harder and harder to move data that way. There's another problem. The data we want now aren't just from traditional healthcare institutions. We want the fitness data. We want a lot of data that exists outside traditional healthcare sources. They're not subject to those same regulations. And data holders are no better able to coordinate among each other than people are. It's hard to get all of the entities that hold part of your health data to come together and share it. Lower right is a possible option. Just have Congress say, we're going to force the sharing of everybody's data with or without consent. That doesn't work for a lot of reasons. We use it rarely for important public health purposes, but it would be very unpopular. And then also, just getting the data won't do it. You need to also engage the data holder in doing labor to make the data interoperable, and the government can't force civilians to work. So none of those three quadrants will work. What we're left with is the last one. We need to engage consumers in getting their own data and then working together to assemble it into large data resources. That's an enormous collective action problem, but I think of all of these solutions, that consumer-driven access is sort of the last option that still has any possibility to work. So the sorts of things that I think may be promising are, first, maybe we should crowdfund bioethics and not have governmental funding agencies do so much of the funding of ethics. I think if it were crowdfunded, people could enunciate for themselves what ethical standards they would like to see explored. Another thing we could do is to empower people with collective bargaining, get lots of people working together. One person can't negotiate the terms of data sharing because they can do without one person's data and still do good research. But if you have 10 million people who are collectively bargaining, they can set some terms that the researchers would have to observe. And then finally, create data collaboratives where you get people getting their data, setting rules on which they'll share it through collective self-governance process. So you have actual self-governing organizations that would be driving data creation for science. Thank you very much.
So Barbara, in this new vision of where research ethics might come from, we've heard of different communities forming of citizens who may share, they may all have a child with type 1 diabetes, or they may share a condition. I'm going to build off Phyllis Kahn's question about children. So what do we do if a research community says, great, we're going to develop our own bioethics, and in our bioethics, whatever the parents want to try with their affected child, green light, full steam ahead, because that would be very different from our current rules, where there is IRB scrutiny of a protocol involving children. If it's an older child, you need the child's assent as well as parental permission. But hypothetically, this community says, forget it, full steam ahead. What's your view?
My view is that these communities of people who get their data and form data communities should be under the same rules that we use for contracting in our society. There is an age of capacity to contract, and I don't think minors should be allowed to make these decisions. I think any system you have, law still has a role to play, even if people are consensually setting their own ethical rules. You need for their promises to their members to be enforced. You need some restraints and having a guardian ad litem or a IRB that would protect the interests of minors whose parents would volunteer their data for research. So I think you would only have communities of people who have the capacity to make these decisions who would be setting their own rules.
Do others have a view on and how, you know, when the people calling the shots are the adults, mm-hmm. but the research subject is a minor. Yeah. How do we protect the minor in this brave new world?
I think it's a great question. I don't currently do any work in children. And I don't think I have any really grounded thing to add other to the conversation.
Yeah, other I think, yeah, than having some type of guardian, like an institutional or community-based IRB, someone who actually can provide guidance on what is ethical is probably the best way forward.
You know, I do work a little bit with children, and my children population is not from the U.S. They are from other parts of the world, where at least historically I've seen that parents can become a hindrance than a help for a whole variety of reasons. I'm not going to argue and debate about it. So I think, you know, if a kid born with congenital heart disease, has as much right to live and access to care than a kid born here in the Twin Cities. The question is, parents, for a variety of reasons, get in the way. And I think the more important question is to make sure that whoever needs whatever care, wherever, gets it, right? So from that standpoint, creating an awareness, I mean, it's so important. And I think part of a recurring theme in all of this is just that this is a new day. I mean, and I think the more you share, the more you'll get out of that, you know, the ability to, and you'll know more. So I think we need to widen the scope of our conversation on a global scale, where parents, as much as you would like to think, have the capacity to make decisions, but wrong decisions.
Okay, questions? Yes.
I have a question, a couple points I want to make.
Could you introduce yourself?
My name is Bill Loteng. I'm a professor here in College of Pharmacy. In the case of the device, for example, where they're coupling a glucose monitor with an insulin pump, there was a study here at the university where they were comparing people who had really tight regulation of glucose levels versus people who just had standard care. That particular study was stopped because they found that those people with real tight glucose levels were actually doing much worse than those individuals with standard of care. A second issue is the person who made the Marfan device for the aorta. What has actually been found with Marfan syndrome, it's a serum level of TGF-beta, which is sequestered by the fibrillin, which actually causes the problems, and not the fact that you need to support the aorta in individuals that have Marfans. So here we have two devices that are being put out that potentially could actually be harmful and not taking care of the problem that these people think that they're dealing with. So the FDA, on the other hand, when they're doing things, they're looking at all this information, which most people may not either be looking for or understand or even really care about because it's getting in the way of them putting out their device. So how do you control for that? How do you make sure that when these devices are thrown out there, they're passed along on the internet, they're not really being vetted like they should be, and actually you're bringing harm to people who think they're really doing good?
So I can speak a little bit to the open artificial pancreas solution in the way that they've gone about thinking through this, because, I mean, it's a device that can cause irreparable harm and death if done incorrectly, is that algorithms are not published, is that the communication pathways are published, and that you have a community of people that work together so that you can understand, an individual or a family, a care team can come in and understand how to help these devices talk to each other. But once it gets down to what do you want them to actually say to each other, that becomes a personal liability and a personal choice. And they, from what I understand, they are as much a teaching community as a kind of technical community. And they go to great deals to make sure people understand that this thing is not Legos. It is far, far more complicated.
and that you have to pay attention. And it is not a solution, and that it is not a cure. And that as you develop those algorithms, you develop the software that actually is running that artificial pancreas, that there are pathways in the software that allow for you to take control away from that software.
One comment here, but the main point is that they're not in aggregate looking at what's happening. There may be 200 of these devices out there. If 10% of them, the kids are dying, who's going to know that? I mean, at least within a study, you're tracking what's going on.
Can I add to that? It's interesting. So the Night Scout community has actually reached out to integrate and has completed an integration with Open Humans so that it's not published yet. But people who want to bring their data into a platform that connects to the research community, but isn't controlled by the research community, but connects to it. And there's already the first researcher who has set up to organize a study of Night Scout users' data that is sort of still controlled by the users, but so that they now, in this stage of evolution, have connected or connecting their platform to a platform that connects them to researchers.
Go ahead.
I think the example you give points to a broader problem. Clearly, in that situation, FDA has jurisdiction to regulate that study. It can regulate a sponsor investigator study, which is a study where the same person sponsoring it is the investigator, and I think much citizen science fits into that. And it can require an investigational device exemption and then regulate the course of the protocol used to study it and require a clearance or approval for the device. So the law is where it needs to be in making this sort of activity regulable. But what the challenge is going to be is FDA's regulation has always sort of relied on having a product sponsor that was a responsible corporate entity that would meet the agency halfway in regulatory compliance. With citizen science, the burden is entirely on the agency to get out there and find out these things are happening and then step in and assert jurisdiction. And we're seeing this with do-it-yourself bio, with citizen science in devices. We need to make sure we have the right resourcing and funding of our agencies to cope with this huge architectural difference in how research is going to be happening. And I think ultimately that's a question for Congress. We need a different way of detecting that research is going on without an IDE when an IDE is needed so that the agency can play the role that it legally can do.
Yes.
Hi, thank you all for your presentations. My name is Emma Vidor Highland. I'm actually a PhD candidate in communication studies here. My question's a little bit longer, so I wrote it down. So it's just for all of you, for anybody who wants to answer. So are these new directions in medicine and our medical futures possible for people without the resources that we've been talking about or that are taken for granted? So resources like time, being able to even purchase wearable technologies, having access to medical professionals more generally. There's more to this. Sorry, my phone just went away. So what is being done either in the work that you do or work that you know of to include those populations without those resources in the research or treatments? And then do you see it as an ethical problem with reaching out to treat those populations with the fewer resources only after these tools are developed rather than including them during the initial stages of development? So just how are you trying to compensate for populations with fewer resources?
Great, thank you.
I can take a first stab at that. So one example of a sort of underrepresented group in health care access and research is the LGBTQ community. And there was a group of researchers at UCSF that leveraged this research kit framework to develop an app, not to go out to the community and say, hey, we have this great research question, we'd love for you to sign up for our research study. Instead, what they did with that app was to go out to the community and say, we want to know what your priorities are in healthcare and health research so that we can calibrate our initiatives and align with what your actual needs are. And they had an overwhelming response with tens of thousands of people who signed up. And on average, I think each submitted, you know, four or five ideas about things that really affect them and their access to care or problems with the health issues that they're having. And so from that, actually set their research priorities based on community feedback first.
I can only speak to like my hopes and dreams in this area, mostly because I mean I think you're right that the fancy gizmos and gadgets and apps that you know I know and love are typically not going to be used by the underserved population. They're not going to be, not that they can't be useful. It's a matter of I think time, energy, and effort and monetary cost. However, I'm a big believer, for better or worse, in the power of data, and data that is able to move freely at the consent of the individual that is creating it has a unique ability, I think, to help the underserved. There's some really interesting work going on to bring data such as, we were just talking about this last night, your electrical bill into the clinic. So that physicians that are treating patients in low-income populations can have a more robust discussion about the entire life of that patient, rather than how do you feel today, what kind of antibiotic should I give you? It's what is life like, and how is your entire kind of that circle of life, all the way from can you pay your electric bill to what's going on in terms of your health and healthcare. Bringing all of that data to bear, I think, on clinical decision-making, but also in kind of this, what we now call coordinated care support, is going to be really, really interesting in the future as this data becomes more freely available and more movable, I guess.
KK, did you want to comment on the disparities issues?
Sure. So the way I envision this problem, it's nothing new and at one level, which is when you think in terms of realizing the potential of people, creative people, be it from whatever community they are or wherever the geography is. I think the challenge that we are faced with, I mean, you know, it's good to see community labs, is to how do you engage them and keep them engaged in system. There's a huge responsibility here. I think all of a sudden we are trying to do citizen science. In some sense, we believe that we can contribute as much or at par with investigators who are a part of a larger infrastructure. So I think we need to figure out alternative ways. And I think the way companies sometimes do it is they seed projects and they, so, you know, in this new age when we're recognizing the role of individuals and communities, that's probably one of the necessary conditions and almost has to be a part of a public policy, because I think otherwise this is not going nowhere. I mean, even if there may be a lot of flashes in the pan, but no fire. And it goes back to, I think, some of these ideas that I think a gentleman, from my colleague from College of Pharmacy, just spoke about is that we need to be mindful of the downside risk. And one way, at least in the research that we are doing, we are looking fairly closely, and that's how I ventured into this area, is like adverse event data. You know, we looked at medical devices. We like to talk about the upside potential. I've been looking at a lot of FDA's adverse event data. In a way, we can predict recalls, and we can understand what of the nature of recalls. Has there been hospitalization, injuries, deaths? And we can do amazing things if we can do that. So I think, as we think through this, one of the challenges that we have looked at, and I think Jingwen is here, some of our doctoral students, is that we are looking at, for example, new and novel drugs in the precision medicine space, and we start looking at the adverse event data, and we start looking into the details. What we don't know is a lot about the conditions under which these are being administered. So while we know some of the side effects, I think from an FDA standpoint, we need to start providing a lot more protocols in place that would help us understand what are the in situ conditions in which these drugs are being delivered, which is probably causing some of these adverse events. So it's like the horse winning or losing the race. It's the horse jockey on the track. So we can start systematically understanding this. So now we have a new beast in the jungle, i.e. the citizen science, helping to advance. So I think, after all, we're doing medicine, so do no harm should guide us. And not that I want to be risk averse, but what I'm saying is let's not get ahead of ourselves, because currently, the best way we understand the delivery of precision medicine is through looking at adverse event data. And we are doing so ourselves, but we find limits in what we can read into this. let alone how we can do some meaningful analysis.
Yes.
Hi, my name is Tim Church. I'm a professor in the Division of Environmental Health Sciences in the School of Public Health here. I also was formerly in charge of clinical evaluation for Medtronic's tachyarrhythmia division, so I'm highly interested in this topic, and I really have appreciated this discussion that's going on. I think it's very enlightening. I think it points a way to a lot of really powerful new ways that we can take advantage of the intellectual resources in this country to improve our health. But I think along the way, you've also pointed out, and some of the other questioners have pointed out, some of the problems that we faced in trying to harness this and still maintain the safety of our population. And we've certainly seen that large groups of individuals can kind of go off track. We've got the whole anti-vaccination movement where large numbers of people believe things that just aren't true and influence other people to believe it and put all of us at harm. And so we have to be very, very, very careful about it. We've also are very concerned, and I'm very concerned as a researcher, about maintenance of confidentiality and that sort of thing. I did want to mention one thing, and that's that this idea of studying well people is not a new idea. Epidemiologists have been doing it for years and years and years. But this is a new way of doing it and with a new purpose, and I think that's what's key here. I do have a kind of an off-kilter question, maybe to be more provocative than anything else, but it's something that I've thought about a long time. I used to sit on the IRB here. And that's that when somebody walks into a doctor's office, they expect to be treated with the highest medical knowledge that can be applied to their problem. Yet we say it's okay for you to deny your information to be used to improve that medical care. So they expect to benefit from everybody else who has freely supplied their information to the improvement of medical care, but deny that to the next person down the road. How does that fit into our way of thinking about privacy, medical information, and that sort of thing?
Barbara?
One of the only defenses to medical malpractice that tends to work effectively is that if a patient has denied a physician access to information that was material to the decisions the physician needed to make, and then as a result the patient suffers an injury, that's a defense to malpractice. And so in this environment where people are empowered by access to their own data, I think there is perhaps in the future an assertion of a defense to malpractice for that physician who has not received all the information. This recent access that's being afforded under the HIPAA privacy rule to test results has caused concern that the access would lead to new forms of liability for providers. I actually think the flip side of that is it's a defense. If the patient had all their genomic data and didn't share it with the provider and it would have been material, that could protect against liability too.
Can I add something too? So I'm hopeful that in, you know, one of the dimensions of participation that Barbara talked about that has been written up by Christopher Kelty is this educative dividend. And I can't help but think that a lot of the anti-science ideals that we face in this country are part related to our educational system, but part related to the fact that people don't participate in a transparent research environment where it's transactional. You sign a consent form, you give a tube of blood, you answer the survey, then nobody ever talks to you again. And if there's a TV show that is able to get millions of people following it, Mythbusters, that's about the scientific method, like every episode is about the scientific method, then I think there's hope for the research environment to maybe start thinking a little more carefully about engaging people in ways that are interesting. around how science is put together and how the process of medical knowledge is made and how hard that is and how that requires input and that it's gray. And not to only reveal knowledge when you have a high level of certainty. I think that there would be less suspicion in some ways about the scientific research enterprise.
I'll just make one more point, which is, you know, this idea that people don't want to share, even though it's going to advance care for them, their family members, their community, I think is also probably rooted in a social environment in this country where the incentives to share, the fact that that data could go somewhere, had distinct financial repercussions on you. The fact that, you know, we had to wait this long until you could get health insurance without worrying about pre-existing conditions, or that your genetic information, you could not be discriminated based on the fact of your genetic discrimination, is so recent that I do not think we have made the leap as a culture to really kind of put those changes into our social practice. And so I think there's probably, we still need a little bit of time to wake up that this is the world that we live in now. Hopefully it'll continue to be this way. Who knows what happens? But you know, if it does, then you know, I would say my hope would be that fear of sharing because something may happen to you and so it's going to, you know, cost you money down the line is going to be greatly reduced.
We have reached the end of our time together. I hope you've seen why this lecture series has been so visionary, so important. Join me in thanking our donors and our speakers.